If I could trouble you to please turn all your cell phones off or on to vibrate out of respect to those who are trying to fall asleep. Why are you laughing? Oh, I thought I was joking. Okay, fine. I have been asked to speak on the very sensitive subject of dating and marriage. I do not think there's a big mystery to why there's so much more caution in entering marriage, where society as a whole is losing its confidence in the institution called marriage. I think one of the reasons why there's a renewed legitimization of same-gender marriage is partially due because of the failing of marriage in general in society. I would even venture to suggest that because Shalom Bayit, marriage in general, has become so thwart, so full of many challenges, that in some cases there are young people whose parents are either divorced or separated or married but having a hard time, and therefore an intelligent, educated mind is going to be more careful entering into the marriage process, going to be more cautious during the dating. So I'm only offering this introduction as a way to reduce any judgment that there might be on young singles who are in the dating process. It's fully understandable why it might be that there's more caution and perhaps it's taking longer. They say that there are three rings in life. I'm sure you've heard this. There's the engagement ring, there's the wedding ring, and then there's suffering. Of course, it has no reflection on reality whatsoever. It's pure humor. So we're going to deal tonight with both dating and marriage, and there really is a lot of overlap. So this is where I'm going to begin. I'm going to ask you actually to help me along, and I ask forgiveness. For there was one gentleman I met who heard part of this over Shabbat, so be mehila, please forgive me. Some of it you've already heard. The list. What should be on my list going into the dating process? What am I looking for? So help me over here. What should be on the list of what we're looking for in a marriage partner?
Values.
Values, good values.
Compatibility.
Midot.
Attraction. Personality.
Personality. Ladies, you've got to give them some clues.
Money.
Financially responsible. You want to add that in as well? Okay, we've got midot, values, financially responsible, money, attraction. Anything else?
Religious values.
Religious values. Communication skills. It's a good list. Happy, would you want to add that as well? Healthy, physically, emotionally, if you want to add. No, there's a long list. And these are good items, right? Religious values, values in general, respectful, kind, generous. Should that be on the list? Easygoing, do you want to add that? Don't have to. Yeah? Okay. Forgiving, is that how much is that in? Yeah, you agree? So now, imagine that you have a new app and you are on a date. And under the coffee table, you have in your iPhone this new app which has a program that has all the items on your list. And it has a rating of 0 to 10. And with a slight touch, you can give the rating of how much this young man, this young lady is scoring on each one of your items on your list, right? Attraction. And just go along with me for a few moments. He, she is scoring 10 out of 10 on attraction, 10 out of 10 on religious values, 10 out of 10 on financially independent, secure, and financially responsible, healthy, happy, whatever else you want to add, good sense of humor, kind, generous. Now, you, unknown to you, underneath the other end of the coffee table, he happens to have the same app. And on his list of what he's looking for, you are scoring on his list, 0 to 10, 10 out of 10. And this is the first date. Do you both agree you're probably going to meet a second time? Yes or no? Okay. And it just continues. And after a while, you say, no, this is ridiculous. I'm on three dates and everything I'm looking for is on the... It can't be true. So you then go and do a little bit more investigation and you check out with the assistant preschool teacher that he had. And then you go to a regression therapist to find out which Gilgal he was in and or who he's married to in the previous lifestyle. No, and whoever you talk to, and you ask them, you know, if you gave this guy or this girl a rating 0 to 10 for happiness, for health, for finances, financial responsibility, attraction, religious values, what would they score? And these people are all telling you, oh, well, if you told me it's 0 to 100, I'd tell you it's 100. But if it's 0 to 10, I'll tell you it's 10. But really, it breaks the scale. They're right off the scale. They say, whoa. Now, would it be correct for me to say we can say mazal tov, yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah, do you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah, we got mazal tov, we're in agreement?
Yeah,
sure. Yeah? Any hesitation?
No, the perfect partner was not born yet.
Okay. Okay.
It will change after marriage, a 10 out of a 10.
Oh, okay, so do you agree that if there's any hesitation, add it to your app, go on another date, and check out if they score anything on this? Is it minus? Is it a zero? Is it a 1, 5, 8, 10? And let's just say, just for argument's sake, just go along with me in your imagination for a few moments. That person scores 10 out of 10 on anything and everything that you add to your list. And do you agree that you can say mazal tov, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry, sorry?
If there was an emotional connection to that, you know, between the two rather than between the two lists.
Okay, so they click, right? There's an emotional connection. They somehow enjoy each other's company. Whatever might be missing, add emotional connection. And if you want to add any details to description of what that means, add it to the app, go out on another date, and sure enough, check it off. Oh my gosh, 10 out of 10, every time. So now, here's the real question. Two people get married, they score 10 out of 10 on everything they're looking for. And I agree with the gentleman over there, we're going to get to this in a few moments, about the perfect spouse. But ultimately, here's the real question. Two people score 10 out of 10 on everything they're looking for. Will that equal a happy marriage, yes or no?
No.
Why not? Why will it not guarantee? Yes, it's a very good start. It's an excellent start. Why will it not guarantee a happy marriage? Why not? Okay, we've got to maintain all that, and we've got to grow together. What else? Say more. Oh, things will come up that we've never experienced before. Example.
Children.
Never had a child before. My own child. And he's got his way of raising this child, disciplining this child, putting this child in check, agreeing or not agreeing, how much flexibility, how much to give the child a say, how much to say no, absolutely no. And the other one says, ah, no. And then the kid picks up, oh, I got room here. Not easy. Two people who've never raised a child before might have a different view as to how to raise a child. Or mazal tov, you've got twins. Mazal tov, we've got twins, oh. And is it possible they could be identical and yet have two different personalities? And what is a, no, you cannot have that, is clear for one child, and they back off, and they agree, they cooperate. The other child rebels, just sticks his feet further into the ground and gives you a harder time, and I think we need a different style of parenting for the other child. And yet, one spouse says, no, one style for both, one size fits all, and the other spouse says, no, this child is a different personality, we need to go more easy and find another way. Talking about children, I just finished making my entire house childproof, but they're still getting in. No, I'm just joking. I really love kids. In fact, someone once asked me if I ever hit them. I said, never, ever hit my children. Except in self-defense. So, I'm going to share with you a couple of true stories to illustrate this point. Just because two people have met each other and found everything they're looking for, it does not guarantee the perfect marriage because we cannot anticipate new situations that will come up between us that neither of us have ever experienced before, so we don't know what's going to come out of us because we've never been in this situation before. Even though we're compatible, we seem to agree on everything, on our apps and all our dating, nothing can necessarily be enough preparation for a totally new situation. So for example, he has a totally different way to respond to the new mother-in-law. And it doesn't work for the spouse. And she is having a slight difficulty with her mother-in-law. And guess what? We might have two very different ways of dealing with, look, this is my mother. That's how she is. Yeah, but she's so sharp and how insensitive. So, okay, so just go along with it. Or do I not defend and say, you know what, you're right. I will speak to her, or we're going to have to keep our distance, or whatever it is, or it could be the father-in-law. I haven't got a father-in-law joke. I really need a father-in-law joke. Not just to balance things out a bit. Okay, never mind. So we never know what will come between us that will be a new situation we've never experienced, and so two people cannot know how they're going to respond to this new example. True story. Man marries woman. She's 27, owns a company that she started on her own. I don't want to give too many details. He has several employees. And he is attracted to her more than any other reason for the following. She was abused, forgive me for saying this on camera, she was abused by her father for many years. This went on until early teenage, until she cut off from her father. She had the courage. She was only 13. And from that moment onwards, never spoke to her father. It was 17. From 17 onwards, she had the courage. She broke away from home completely and hasn't spoken or met him in 10 years. He was not at their wedding. This young man was attracted to her more than anything else. This was the major piece, that she was so vivacious, so loving life, so strong internally, and had started her own business, was a happy person, despite the fact that she had gone through this terrible abuse as a child. And the father dies very soon after they get married, and she falls into depression. And he is beside himself. Why is she depressed? And listen to her answer. Astonishing. He didn't know, could never have known this, and she didn't either. She felt depressed because only now she realizes that deep down she was hoping one day her father would come to her and apologize and mean it. And even though that would never undo whatever he had done, it would still be a serious healing for her. And because now he's died and will never actually apologize, she realizes that that was missing for her and only realizes it now and is falling apart. The very item for which he felt she was so strong, she fell apart from. And now the real question is, how will he deal with this? How will she respond? Second scenario, true story. Girl marries boy. I got a great line for you. Boy meets girl. Says, will you marry me? She said, no. They lived happily ever after. Boy meets girl. Says, will you marry me? She says, yes. The end. Boy meets girl, will you marry me? No, but you've got good taste. Boy meets girl, they get married. What she was attracted to more than anything else was security. She for whatever reason, financial security was right at the top of her list. This young man, early 30s, had been in his job for 15 years. That's a long time. His staying power, and he reached a point of promotion. He was earning over six figures, a nice size six figure. Company downsizes within 2 years of their marriage. He's still on board. Soon afterward, the company downsized a second time, lost his job. He had severance, but now he's searching and searching for a new job, and to get a new job coming from where he came from, at the starting point from which he ended, with no offers. And she's falling apart. And here's really the question. What's going to matter the most? Who I marry? Or how will I be in the marriage when differences will surface? When new situations will come up? when there might be some surprises that I didn't see during the dating, and now my husband, my wife, is not as easygoing as I thought, or as generous, or always attentive, or always appreciative, and now how will I respond to that? Will I respond with accusations, blaming, complaining, denying it's my fault, giving excuses why it's your fault that I'm unhappy in this marriage? I call it the A, B, C, D, E of getting out of responsibility. A, accuse. It's your fault! Not you personally, I didn't wake anyone up. I'm sorry. I was in South New Jersey a little while ago, and they heard me wired me up to a microphone, which was, the PA was going around the whole room, and the gentleman in the front row was snoring away. So getting picked up on the PA all across the auditorium. So I said to the guy next to me, could you give him a nudge and wake him up? He says, Rabbi, you got him to sleep, you wake him up. So, you know what? A, accuse. B, blame. I blame you. I gave you the best years of my life. Now, there's no one here who can relate to any of this. Some of you have friends who know what I'm talking about. C, complain. D, deny it's my fault. E, give excuses why it's the other person's fault. And when I play the blame game, as I call it, accuse, blame, complain, or compare, you're just like your father! Not you personally, but when I start complaining, comparing, denying, excusing, the blame game, who has to change? When I play the blame game, who has to change? Me or everyone else? Oh, you have to change, dear spouse, dear kids, dear mother-in-law, father-in-law. I don't have to change. Oh, you have to change. Oh, so I'll play the blame game to get out of responsibility for changing the only person. I was created to change. So the bottom line here, and I'm going to reinforce this with a couple of other examples. Who we marry is not nearly as important as who are we entering the marriage. How strong will I be in controlling my anger? How strong will I be in my patience, my understanding, listening, compassion? All the things on my list is what I have to work on. Easygoing, listening, respect, financially responsible. And I'm going to prove it to you. I'm going to prove it to you that who I marry is not nearly as important as who am I in the marriage, entering marriage. Who I date is not nearly as important as who am I in the dating process? How am I growing in the dating process? And I'm going to prove it to you in just a few moments. Quick question. Is there anyone in this room today who would say, in the last 2 to 5 years, I have not changed, I'm the same person? Same person today as 2, 5 years ago, I haven't grown at all. Is there anyone? Of course not. Everyone changes. How about 10 years ago? Are you the same person today as you were 10 years ago? Of course not. So here is the kind of ironic news. Whoever you marry will not be the same person you stay married to. Yes, the physical person, hopefully, I mean, it'll be the same partner, but that person's going to change because we all change. I'm going to change, she's going to change, he's going to change. So who we marry anyway is going to change. So the real question is not who I marry, the real question is who am I in the marriage? How will I respond when I discover something that I don't like as much as I thought was there, and it's much harder than I thought, whether it's the mother-in-law, the father-in-law, or something to do with your career, or the way you're raising the children, or your finances, or your choice of career, or how you're dealing with your boss, or not dealing with your boss, or how you're not closing enough sales with the clients. No, whatever is my complaint, what's going to matter the most is not your business, it's mine. How will I change me? Because if I try to change you, here's a good question. Do you know anybody who successfully changed their spouse by trying to change them? I'll make the question much easier. Do you know anybody in world history that succeeded in changing their spouse by trying to change them? And the answer is, nobody ever changed anyone. And if it looks as though they change, it's only until their back is turned, and then their spouse will do what they want anyway. I'll make a similar question. Do you know any teenager that was changed by the parent by trying to change the teenager? Anyone here has had teenagers? Will know why some animals eat their young. Pure humor, no reflection on reality whatsoever. I'm sorry, I hope I'm not. It's only meant in humor, it's really not. I was a teenager once myself. Didn't last long, just from 13 till 19. After that, I grew out of it. Who we marry will never be the same person 2, 4, 5 years down the line. In some cases, it won't be the same person a week later. What's going to matter the most is less than who I marry, but who am I entering that marriage? Because we can't change anyone. The only way we change anyone is when we change ourselves. And then you end up responding to a different me. You end up responding to a different spouse. When they become more loving, more appreciative, more giving, more respectful, more listening, you end up appreciating that and responding in kind. You might not want to do it straight away because you might not want to trust the new him, the new her, but that's how we have been wired. We are wired to change in response to people and the way they respond to us. So we actually control that, which is good news. The bad news is I don't control my spouse or my date. The only person I can control is me, but that's good news. Because even when I make a mistake, I can ask for forgiveness. And if he or she makes a mistake, I can offer forgiveness even before they. I can be easygoing about it. And even if it does hurt me, I can talk to Hashem about it. If it hurts me bad enough that I have to speak to you, how will I speak to you is what's going to matter the most. Sharp words, accusations. Will it be with blaming, complaining, accusing? Or will it be asking? You know, we had that conversation yesterday. So the reason I want to bring this up is because, and then you explain, without screaming, without shouting, without sharp words, without insults, without hurtful words. And if they sense that I am genuinely, sincerely asking for clarity, I'm not accusing with a loud voice. I'm not comparing. I'm not coming up with a long history of other crimes you've committed against me, which is not a good idea because you might have a better memory than I do about my mistakes in the relationship, and then we're really spiraling downwards. It all matters about not who I marry, but what will come out of me in the marriage. The Chafetz Chaim, the saintly Rabbi Yisrael Meir Kagan, he died about 105 years old in 1933. When he was 16, that's when he married, 16 turning 17. That was in the 18... Whoa. Can someone help me with the math?
17.
1817. Round about 1817. Thank you. His mother was a widow who had remarried. In those days, you're talking about well over almost 200 years ago. In those days, if a lady lost a husband, Rahman al-Islam, to remarry, you couldn't really have a long list. It really had one item. Can he support me? Will I have food on the table? And she compromised as was necessary, and she ended up marrying someone of a much coarser, less refined personality. And indeed, he brought into the marriage his daughter from his previous marriage. When he first set eyes on the young Chafetz Chaim, Rabbi Yisrael Meir Kagan, he wanted that boy to be his new son-in-law and marry his daughter. And he started putting pressure on the Chafetz Chaim's mother. I heard this story from Rabbi Yaakov Greenwald, who heard it from the Chazon Ish, if I'm not mistaken. And he told me the following. The Chazon Ish said that Yisrael Meir Kagan came home from yeshiva, one ben azmanim, between terms, and he saw his mother was upset. He was a very sensitive young man. He saw something was upsetting her. And he asked her, what's the matter? She said, nothing. But she could not hide how hurt she was, because she knew this young boy is a child prodigy, he's a saintly personality, and he is a Talmud Chacham at his young age. He's probably going to go somewhere, and he could easily be supported and groomed to become a leader in the Jewish people. And he asked her again, mother, what's the matter? And she couldn't hold back, and she broke down, uncontrollable tears. And she told him the truth. My new husband wants you for a son-in-law. And you know what his answer was? Mother, why are you crying? I'll marry her. And he did. And he still became the Chafetz Chaim. So the Chazon Ish brought this story, which, by the way, is less known. The Chazon Ish himself had a very difficult marriage. And maybe that's why he was describing this and helping people to realize this is a reality. Who we marry is not nearly as important as who are we entering the marriage. We can be supportive or lose our love and appreciation, respect. Or we can hold on to the nekudot tovot, the good points in that person's personality, what we originally admired in their character, the qualities of their personality, and not let go. Or I can choose to start thinking about what I don't like about you, and if I do that enough times, I'll end up not liking you, stop loving, and eventually, God forbid, end up resenting or even hating. And before we know it, divorce. And I'm here to claim people don't get divorced because of the differences. People get divorced because they can't handle the differences. It's too much. It's not the differences. It's how we deal with the differences. I was speaking in Kutches, Chol HaMoed Pesach, a number of years ago. You're familiar with Kutches in the country?
Sure, I just got back.
Oh, you just got back?
Yes.
So there were about...
Oh,
yeah? There were about 400 people in the audience. I think the average age was about 107. There was one lady there, 104. Very astute. Her mind was really... Whoa. Someone asked her what's special about your age. She said, no peer pressure. So I said to them, you know what, the average age, to be honest with you, was around about, I would say, what, 75 to 85? A mature audience. I mean, they've been through life. They've seen death, Second World War, tragedy. They've been through everything. And I asked them, you know what, I imagine in the room, the average age here is about 50. The ladies were very happy with that number. So I said, you know what, let's figure out together, there's about 400 people in the room, and each person's age, 50 years, you're 50 years, you're 50 years, you're 50 years, you're 50 years, and we go around the room. How many years would be the total of 50 times two times 400? You could take a vote if you want. 20,000. So you know what, I said, this is interesting. In this room, there are 20,000 years of a cumulative life experience. Let me ask you a question. In your wisdom, experience 20,000 years. Let's answer the following question. I'm offering you two options. What will make two people happy in marriage? Number one, is it how similar we become and less different over the years of the marriage? And that's what makes us more and more happy. More similar and less different. Or is it number two? Not how similar we become and less different, but how well we respond to the differences. How we handle a new situation, this child, this parent, this school situation, this health setback, this financial setback. And guess, out of 20,000 years of a cumulative life experience, guess how many people in that room? 400 people, mature audience. Guess how many people said, happiness in marriage depends on how similar we become and less different. Guess how many? Zero. Isn't that amazing? One person said, I want you to know I'm married 63 years. And he had a great line. He said, I want you to know, marriage is not a word. It's a sentence. He meant it, of course, in pure humor. No reflection on reality whatsoever. Are you okay with marriage jokes?
Yes.
You sure? Okay. Cassandra hadn't come to shul for a number of weeks. And eventually she turned up. And the rabbi said, Sandra, I haven't seen you for a while. Is everything okay at home? She says, no, things are not okay. Why? What happened? My husband died. Your husband died? I never knew about this. What happened? You don't want to know. Now tell me, really, were you there when he died? Of course I was there. What were his last words? You don't want to know. No, please tell me what were his last words. His last words were, Sandra, put down the gun. Pure humor, no reflection on reality whatsoever. You gotta laugh at life. It gets us through everything. Happiness in marriage is not dependent on how similar we are and less different. It helps a lot, but that's not where it counts the most. What's going to count the most is how will I respond to your frustration, your anger, your disappointment, even in me. How will I get angry back? Will I pull out my list of my disappointments? Or will I be patient, accepting, understanding? Not out of weakness, out of strength. Be patient with love, admiration, and not let go. That's what's really going to count the most. So I'm going to share with you the following. What is the purpose of marriage? What is the purpose of marriage? Well, children, okay. But, you know, God, if he wanted to, in his infinite wisdom, he could have had children grow on trees. Some parents might have found that much easier. You know, it saves a lot of labor. I don't mean that as a pun, but it saves a lot of labor and it saves a lot of tzargil, but, you know, just pick them off the tree when they're ripe, and if they ever ripen. God wants us to be connected to our children through the partnership of husband and wife. Why? What's the purpose of marriage? The real purpose of marriage is to force two people to see not the other person, but themselves. Because alone, I'm just not going to look at me. I'm not. I'm not going to change me without help. So how does God help me change me? L'tov heyot adam levado. God says, you know what? It's not good for a man to be alone. E'aseh ezer kenegdo. So I'm going to make for him an ezer, a partner to help him. Now here's where it gets really interesting. The actual language there is, in the correct translation, it doesn't mean it's not good for a person to be lonely, because then it should be lihyot levado, to be lonely. It says heyot levado, which means to be alone. What's the difference? In English, you can't really hear the subtlety. But the Hebrew grammar, basically what it's really saying is there's two types of loneliness. There's a loneliness where I don't have companionship. That's lihyot levado. But that's not what God says. He's not talking about me missing a companion. He's talking about a different type of loneliness, which is much worse. Heyot adam levado means I'm alone, I don't even have me. What does that mean? I'm not there for myself. Whether it means I don't take care of myself, or I feel so low about myself, I don't take myself seriously, and that's why people pick up very quickly that I don't take myself seriously, so they don't take me seriously either. If I'm not there for me, because I'm not even willing to look at myself, because I'm so busy blaming the world, complaining about how other people and circumstances have ruined me, hurt me. So I'm busy not looking at me. I'm busy looking at everything around me that I'm faulting for ruining my happiness, my life. So comes along God and says, you know what? The only way I'm going to help this guy Rietti to really look at himself is I'm going to give him a marriage partner who's not always the same and often not the same, and it will force him to look in the mirror with a magnifying glass in between. And that's what marriage is. Husband and wife, after a few days after Shiva Barachot, start noticing, oh, I didn't know you had that pimple on that part of your body before. Sorry. I didn't realize that part of your personality, and it's and all sorts of what I might interpret as defects start showing, little kinks, little scratches in my armor, and the mirror with a magnifying glass in between is showing up all my inconsistencies. So the purpose of marriage is for me to see me. Because when we enter marriage, and this is not to make us more scared, this is just a reality check. It's God's, I don't want to call it sense of humor necessarily, but this is God's way of helping me change me. Because on my own, I'm not going to do it. So Hashem wants me to change me, and one of the ways he accelerates that process is marriage, children, and the workplace. These are the places where we constantly encounter different people, difficult people, and forces me to come out of me. God is in the business of squeezing What does squeezing mean? It's actually a Midrash Rabbah. You'll find it in Shemot, where God compares the Jewish people to an olive. And just like an olive is squeezed, and out comes the olive oil, well, what decides the quality of the oil? How hard you squeeze? Or the ripeness of the olive? Oh, it's the maturity of the olive. Oh, so when God squeezes me through marriage, through children, through mother-in-law, father-in-law, brother-in-law, when God squeezes me through my clients and my boss and my co-worker and my chevruta and the community and the extended family and my neighbor and... Have we covered everybody? When God squeezes me through lots of different people, what comes out when he squeezes me? What comes out? Whatever's inside. So if I'm immature, what will come out when you squeeze me? Whoever you are. Immaturity. If I've got anger, bitterness, resentment, and I easily fault other people, guess what will happen when you squeeze me? Whether it's the traffic, whether it's the carpool, whether it's the client who I can't believe is just dragging me along and is just not closing the deal, and I start really irritated, and I start, it comes out in, and the client doesn't want to have to do with me. Oh, what happens when I'm squeezed? Whatever's inside comes out. For who to see? Oh, for me to see. It's real intimacy. Real intimacy is into me see. The way God gets me to see into me is he puts me into marriage to help me change. The only person I'm capable of changing. And when we do, how do we feel? When we improve our patience, admiration of qualities in the other person. When we're more forgiving and let go of resentment. Even if I feel he, she doesn't deserve it. But if I can find it in my heart, guess who's the real beneficiary? Who's the person who's really benefiting when we forgive someone? Is it the other person or ourselves? Let's be honest, it's ourselves. Who goes to sleep that night? Who sleeps that night? Who's able to wake up next morning and say, you know what, I'm starting my life again. I can continue. But if I'm carrying resentment, anger, bitterness towards anybody or God or circumstances, the market or people, who's really suffering? And who's causing it? I can blame, point fingers, but the real person who's entertaining all this, controls all this, is myself. And that's what's affecting my emotions. So comes along God and says, I'm going to help with a crash course in changing oneself. And it's called marriage. It's called having children. It's called going to work. It's called interfacing with different people. One of the problems we're experiencing today is with texting. And communication through technology is that we're not facing each other with the body language and talking directly, and we're losing out on a massive proportion of the real communication, which is body language, tone of voice. And so many emails are going back and forth, destroying each other, where we're picking apart line, paragraph, and responding to each, and then the other person reads and can't realize that it's not as severely meant as the words seem to suggest. And there are things I'm saying in the email that if it was person to person, I probably wouldn't have the guts to do, and so I would be more refined and perhaps more understanding, because I'm giving you a chance face to face to respond as we talk. Is it possible that technology is accelerating the pace of communication, but in many ways it's diluting our relationships? The quality is really not the same anymore. So comes along God and says, you know what? Marriage is the place for us to get stronger in communication, trust, respect, giving, forgiveness, generosity. We're practicing that all the time. We're practicing improving ourselves. So that's really the purpose of marriage. It's not about compatibility. That's a plus. That's bonus. But that comes more and more with... how do I respond to your differences? That's what's going to count the most. How will you respond to my differences? But you know what's interesting over here? I don't have to wait for you to be nicer to me, because if I realize, you know what, I'm going to take the position that it's my responsibility to change me. And I start being more kind, appreciative, giving, forgiving, listening, compassionate, understanding, less judgmental. Guess what will happen? The other person will change in response, because that's how we are wired. We have been programmed that way. just like the facial expressions reflect each other's faces in the water. The water reflect our facial expressions without the slightest deviation. Kein lev ha'adam le'adam. So is the mind and heart. Because the word lev means both. We'll talk about maybe another time. Lev really means mind and heart. The mind and hearts of other people are reflecting what we're thinking and feeling. Kein lev ha'adam le'adam. There's no deviation. What I'm thinking and feeling about you is what you're picking up on. And when I fall out of love, there's no mystery. You know what I'm doing? I'm thinking more about what I don't like about you and what I'm discovering that's negative in my perception, and I'm letting it reach over here and I start feeling it. Guess what's going to happen? You're going to pick up on it. And if I really want to turn around the dating, the marriage, the relationship with this child, where should I begin? Over here. If I try changing you, any type of changing you, that label, complaint, is a complaint. That's what it is. Any attempt for me to change you, no matter how nice I package it, is basically a complaint that says, you know, when you lose a bit more weight, then I'll love you. When you're more appreciative, then I'll appreciate you. You know, when you earn more money, then I can respect you. When you stand up for yourself to your boss, then I'll have respect for you. When you have better taste in clothes, then I'll admire you. And even if I package it in the nicest possible words, when you're better with the children, when you cook better, whatever it is, it's a complaint. And there's very few people in this world who can take a complaint, nod their heads, and say thank you. People aren't wired that way. We're not wired that way. Have you ever heard of a couple that in the first week of marriage, husband comes to the wife and says, you know what, I've got a list here of things that I think you could improve on in the marriage. And I think, you know, let's get this straight at the beginning so that we don't have this. Now, how many women do you know said, oh, this is wonderful. You know, I've always looked forward to growing in marriage. This is fantastic. You're telling me all the things you don't like about me. Now I know what to grow in. Oh, this is great. What is it you don't like about me? You know, no one speaks that way. You call that Sala. What's the matter? What happened to them? We're not wired to appreciate criticism. But we are wired to appreciate appreciation, gratitude, admiration. Even when we make mistakes and the other person is more forgiving, more listening, more patient, and has done chavzchut on us, judges us favorably, looks for a positive interpretation. Oh, you know what? I'm not judging you. If I were in your shoes, I'd probably do much worse. You really mean it? Yeah, for sure. Oh, so real happiness in marriage is not about how similar and less different we are. It helps, but it's not about that. It's really about what will come out of us when differences come between us. It's interesting that the mitzvah of mitziyut hazivug is not chippus, it's not searching, it's finding. Ladies and gentlemen, in the language, what's the difference between searching and finding? What's the difference? Is it just semantics, just language, or is there a gigantic difference? What's the difference between searching for the right partner versus the language our sages give us, which is mitziyut hazivug, finding the right partner? What's the difference? Finding means it's absolute, meaning to say.
Final.
It's final, meaning to say. Carry on. Add on.
There.
It's there. Now, what does that mean? The right person is there? Yep. Can it also mean the right in every potential person is there? The good in every potential person is there? See, what am I supposed to be looking for during the dating process? All the things I'm looking for on my list? And like the gentleman over there said, there's no such thing as a perfect spouse.
Only now, the first three priorities.
Let's hear them.
Race.
Okay. Do you want to tell us what your three are? Okay, whatever your top three are, go for it. Whatever you decide is your top three, go for it. I play soccer on Wednesday nights, RCC. So there's a guy there, cell phone goes off while we're in the locker room. And he picks up the cell phone and it's his wife. He says, oh, darling, I'm so glad you picked up. No, I was just at the mall. I can't tell you, there's this gorgeous leather jacket on sale for $1,000. What do you say? someone who's on speakerphone, we're looking at him, says, how's he going to handle his wife? I'll get it. Oh, darling, thank you so much. Before you put the phone down, I just want to tell you, on the way to the mall, I passed the Mercedes dealership, and the new SLR 500 is on sale for $65,000. What do you say? Is it fully loaded? Yes. Okay, get it. Oh, darling, thank you so much. Listen, before you put the phone down, you remember that beautiful home that we fell in love with? They took it off the market. It was going for $1.3 million. It's back on the market, reduced to $1.1 million. What do you say? Come in with an offer for $1.25 million. Oh, darling, I love you. Yeah, I love you too. Bye. Bye. Now, we're all staring at this guy. Oh, my gosh. No one's going to compete with this man. He's so good to his wife. You know what he says to us? Whose cell phone is this? There's no such thing as a perfect husband. There's no such thing as a perfect spouse. The only thing that matters is not who I marry. That's important, but it's not going to matter in the final analysis. What's going to matter the most is what comes out of me in the marriage. Who will I become during marriage? Because who I marry anyway is not going to be the same person. Yes, sir?
The only one that we promise you a perfect one will be a shapchen. And my rabbi says shapchen is sheker dover, kesef notel.
Okay, I'm laughing because I thought you were joking. Okay. Metziut hazivuk really means don't look for the good in the other person. Find it. It's there. You can't look for something that's not there. Finding means it's already there. Let me show you how the Torah describes loving another person. Which mitzvah in the Torah tells me I have a mitzvah to love you? Ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. Chapter 19 in the book of Vayikra. And this one line is so popular, Christianity adopted it. The whole world, love your neighbors yourself. Listen carefully. L'reacha. What's the two-letter root of reacha? Ra. What does ra mean? Bad. Ask Rabbeinu Yonah. In Share Teshuvah, in paragraph 219, Reshu Tet, why does Hashem use the language Ra, two-letter root of Reacha, which means your friend, your neighbor, and it refers to the negative? Ra means bad. V'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. Why didn't he use the language of Chaver, where you're joining together? Says Rabbeinu Yonah, an amazing insight, God knows there's no such thing as a perfect friend. If I'm only going to look for a friend that will never disappoint me, never let me down, always be sensitive, and never hurt my feelings, how long will I be looking for a friend? How many friends will I have? Everyone's going to eventually trip up in some way and hurt me in some way. Oh, ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha means love them with the negativity as well. Because if I'm going to be stuck on, I can only love someone who never hurts me or doesn't let me down, never ever breaks the trust in any way, which I'm going to be looking for a long time. Rabbeinu Yonah says a similar comment in the Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, in Perek Aleph. He tells us, Aseh lecha rav, make for yourself a teacher, a mentor, ukneh lecha chaver, be willing to spend money on a friend. And when you have a choice of seeing someone do something wrong, you saw it, you heard it, but there's a possible interpretation, even if it's only in your imagination, that puts what they did or said into a positive light, that it's not so bad. Which am I supposed to select? What I saw and heard and judge you on that, or in my imagination? Select a version, the interpretation that puts you in a good light. Which one am I supposed to select? And what does the Torah tell us? B'tzedek tishpot amitecha. Judge others favorably. Which our sages in this Mishnah, Perek Aleph, Mishnah Tet Vav, I think it is, tells us, judge everyone favorably. Says Rabbeinu Yonah, what's this doing over here? And he says, very simple. If I'm looking for a rabbi that will never let me down, if I'm looking for a friend that will never let me down, how long will I be looking? Forever! Ein tzadik ba'aretz she'aseh tov lo yechta. There's no such thing as a human being who's righteous, that walks this earth and never makes a mistake. Oh, there were five exceptions, the Gemara tells us, but otherwise, there's no such thing. Oh, so the purpose of friendship is to not just look for the good, find it and stay with it. Keep finding more and more of the good, because that's the only way I'm going to be able to hold on to friendships. How flexible I am, easygoing, patient, listening, will that help friendships? A lot. Oh, that will help. How much will that help in marriage? Listening, easygoing, flexible, a lot. Oh, it's everything. I'm going to take questions at the end. Please forgive me. So Be'ahavta Racha Kamocha is helping me understand Hashem gives me a mitzvah to love you with the negativity that's in you. And He still wants me to love you. So what am I being asked to focus on? Focus on the good. Focus on the good. Doesn't mean deny the bad. No. Talk to Hashem about what you don't like. Don't talk to your parents and don't talk to your parents-in-law. Not a good idea. It's not my words, Rabbi Victor Miller says it. He has 10 commandments of marriage. We're going to cover many of them in just a few moments. Get to the practicals in just a few moments. Don't share with your parents or parents-in-law. And the reason why is because you might make up with your husband, your wife, and the mother, father is still stuck with the complaints they've heard. And it's very hard for them, very hard for them to remain impartial, to remain parev, without interfering or trying to find a way to persuade the daughter-in-law, the son-in-law. And says Rabbi Victor Miller, husband and wife, they might have made shalom weeks or months ago. Meanwhile, in the gallery, in the ladies' section on Yom Kippur, the mother-in-law is crying tears because she's so angry at the son-in-law, the way she heard from her daughter the treatment that she got. And meanwhile, husband and wife made up a long time ago and she's still angry. And on Yom Kippur, why do I need my mother-in-law or my father-in-law crying about their daughter when she and I made up already? So says Rabbi Victor Miller, do your best not to have to go to them or extended family. Do your best to go to someone impartial. Actually, the first stop is each other. Try and figure it out together. If I still can't, then go to a rabbi, preferably someone who understands both of us and can help, or some other a professional. Try to avoid going to the in-laws, because it usually, not always, but most of the time, is going to end up backfiring on both of us. And then they'll take sides and push us away from each other. Let me share with you an amazing insight. Rabbi Chia Gadol, is a Gemara in Yibamot, Sam Gimel Amud Bet. Rabbi Chia was one of the towering tzaddikim mentioned in the Gemara many times. He had a difficult marriage. His wife was abusive towards him in public. Very often would be mevaze, would embarrass him, humiliate him in public. On one occasion, he's walking through the marketplace with his nephew, Rav. Rav was very famous as well. And Rabbi Chia saw an item that he knew his wife would like. He bought it and he covered it in his scarf and took it home. Rav said to his uncle, Rabbi Chia, why are you being so nice to her? She humiliates you in public and we're embarrassed for you. Why are you being so nice to her? His answer was amazing. He said, let me explain to you. There are two qualities my wife has that for those two qualities alone, and he doesn't say this on himself, he says it for everybody. Dayenu, it's enough to love her, appreciate and admire her for these two qualities alone. Anything else I get is plus. But these two are bare minimum, and if I've got these two, she deserves all my love and appreciation. And what are they? Number one, Dayenu shigadlenu et banenu. It's enough, Dayenu, to love them, because they raise our children. 9 months pregnancy, that's not easy. Woo, woo. X number of hours of labor, whoa. Childbirth, and then Sargidul Banim raising that child. Who's home most of the time raising that child? The mother. Said Rabbi Chia, I owe her love and respect, admiration, just for number one, Dayenu Shigadlenu et Banenu, and number two. It's a mature audience. You'll be mochel. Forgive me for sharing with you what Rabbi Chia tells us. Everybody. Umatzeleinu minahet. and they save us from thinking about other women. Because in the bedroom, they provide what's called pat pesalo. Pat pesalo is an expression, a basket full of bread. What does that mean? So our sages tell us a number of times, Einu dome, someone who's fasting, who's not eating or drinking, but yesh pat pesalo, they've got bread in the basket, and they're going to break the fast, or they've got what to eat. But if the refrigerator is empty and they're fasting, who's having an easier time? The one who's got bread in the basket. The one who's not got anything in the basket, the refrigerator's empty. Even when the fast is over, there's no food to eat. It's much worse. So comes along our sages and warn someone who is married and husband and wife behave in the bedroom. What does that mean? He doesn't say, you know what, forget about the mikveh this month. If that's how you're going to behave, forget it. Don't even bother. And she doesn't use it against him. Right, I'm not going for our... That's it, forget about it. Sleep on the couch. And comes along Rabbi Victor Miller, based on this gemara, and says, never throw a spouse out of the room, ever. The bedroom is Kodesh HaKadoshim. The bedroom is the Holy of Holies. That don't bring the differences into the bedroom. And if there are differences, make up, make shalom. But don't let it destroy that part of the marriage. Because if, God forbid, a husband holds back, the wife is going to go elsewhere. Or if, God forbid, the wife holds back, husband will start thinking and giving a second look. It's not worth it. It's so not worth it. And comes along Rabbi Chia and says, yeah, you see that she's disrespectful to me in public. But let me just tell you, for those two alone, it's worth loving, respecting, and admiring. And he's not giving it as personal advice about himself. He's saying, Dayenu, it's enough for us. Oh, this is generic advice. But when my list gets very long about all my expectations, I'm hurting myself. I'm hurting you. I'm being unfair to myself. How we behave, respond to the differences is what's really going to matter, not what's on my list. So I'm going to share with you some of the practicals. Always make up as soon as possible. Make shalom as soon as possible. Interesting word. Shalom does not... It means peace, but it means completion from the word shalem. So shalom bayit really means that before it was shalem, it was not shalem, it was not complete. Oh, so shalem actually means when different parts come together to make completion. That's what shalom is. Shalom is when different parts coexist. And the proof is, Rashi brings this right at the beginning of Bereshit, Ose shalom bimromav. How does God make peace above in Shemayim? What is Shemayim made up of? Shemayim, Sham, Mayim. Oh, there's water, Sham, Mayim. That's what the word is made up of. How did water get there? Water is heavy, it's on the oceans. How do you get water into the air? Oh, evaporates. How do you do that? Oh, Eish, fire from the sun, forces evaporation, and gravity enables the water to now change into vapor, and it arises because of the heat of the sun. So says Rashi, Gemara in Chagigah Yud Bet tells us, Eish, Aleph is a silent letter. The word Shemayim is made up of Eish and Mayim. Two opposites. Ose Shalom b'miromav. Hashem is making peace between opposites. He wants us to do the same. Because the Ikka Shalom, and this you'll find in Likutei Moran, from the famous Breslov Rebbe, Rabbi Nachman of Breslov. He says in Torah 49, in Likutei Moran, he says, Ikka Shalom is Shnei Chafechim. Is when you got two opposites, mitchabrim, coming together. Oh, so real shalom is not how similar we are. Real shalom is the coexistence of differences. Is you being different and I still love you. Me being different and you still accept, respect, listen, understand. Oh, I don't have to try and change you. And if I do try, it won't work. It never has. The only thing that does work is changing me. And then you respond differently. So make shalom as soon as possible. Because I don't want to go to sleep with anger, resentment. It's poison. Rabbi Victor Miller also offers that the mitzvah of Ahavta Recha Kamocha applies to dating. That means you have a mitzvah to love the girl, the boy you go out with. Now what does that mean? The word love in the secular world has different connotations, romantic connotations, affection. It's not talking about that. The mitzvah of love is to focus on the good that's in the other person. That's what love really is. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu commands me to love him, it's not emotion he's commanding me. Because if it's an emotion, well, right now I don't feel like it. Just came out of Auschwitz. I don't feel love for God. What I've seen, how can I love God? God's not commanding me to love him over here. He's commanding me to love him over here. What does that mean? Look for the good that this person has done that will make you feel love for him. God, am I still breathing oxygen? When was the last time you gave me a gravity bill? A rainfall bill? When did you last give me an oxygen bill? Rietti, you have not paid your oxygen bill or gravity bill for 54 years. That is pathetic. Oh, okay, God. Do you take credit cards? I mean, how am I going to pay that off? God is saying, I want you to love me. What does that mean? Look for reasons that will cause you to love me. Look for the kindnesses I've done for you that will cause you to love me. So it almost doesn't matter what I've been through. I still have a mitzvah to love you, even with whatever I've been through, because what's God commanding me? Look for the good. Because the good is always much more than whatever is not good. And if I am going to count the good, the bad, then I should at least also count the good. Listen to the logic. If I'm going to complain about what I don't like about you, I should at least be consistent with my own logic and tell you what I like about you. The mitzvah of love is to look and find the good in other people, and including myself. Because it says kamocha, I have to love you like I love myself. Well, what happens if I hate myself? How much do I have to love you now? What happens if I'm suicidal? How much do I have to love you now? I have to love you like I love me. Well, if I hate me, oh, so the mitzvah starts with I gotta love me. What's that mean? Look for the good that exists inside me. Find the good that exists inside me. Find the good that exists inside other people. When I'm going on the dating process, don't hope to find, expect. Unfortunately, the Christians translate our word kaveh as hope. It doesn't mean that. Kaveh does not mean hope. Give up hope. Kaveh means expect. Mikveh, you don't hope to come out tahor. When you go in, I go in tameh, spiritually impure, come out tahor, spiritually pure. I don't hope to come out tahor, I expect to. Same lashon, mikveh comes from kaveh. Kaveh is actually a straight line. Perek Bet in Yehoshua, when Rahab put the kav, is echuta kav, was a straight line of a string. Because a straight line means you can determine every single point that the two ends of the line are going to go through. You don't hope to figure that out, you know, you expect it. Kav el Hashem does not mean hope to God. Give up on hope and expect God to come through for you. Kav el Hashem v'yametz libecha, and he will strengthen your mind, because that's what lev most of the time means. V'kav el Hashem, and then expect again. Expect on the next date to notice something good about the person you didn't notice in the previous date. Expect to learn more about myself in that dating process. Because if I keep going only with, I hope I find all the things I'm looking for, maybe I will, maybe I won't. Give up hope. I hope I lose weight. I hope I'll make more money. No! Forget about hope. Expect to lose weight. That's a whole different statement. I expect to lose weight is much stronger because it's saying I'm going to do something about it. But when I'm hoping, I hope the weather is good. I hope the market turns out. I hope I make money on that deal. I hope my husband will love me. I hope my wife will be more respectful. I hope my kids will turn out good. I hope my kids will stay strong and from religious. Forget about hope. Expect, because expect expects of me to do more. Hope is, I'm going to wait back and see what happens. Will I lose weight? Will he be more loving, more respectful? Will she be more affectionate? Forget, no. Expect by changing me. More exercise, eating better foods, more healthy foods, and expect to be healthier. Don't hope for it, expect it. Put money aside, expect to have money down the road for things that are of greater value, or maybe even a pension. Because if I'm putting money aside, if I can, hey, I don't hope to have a pension, I'm expecting it. I know because I'm putting money aside. That's what we're talking about. Expect to find the good in yourself and in a spouse, in the dating process. There's more to be said. I'm sorry I've gone over time. Okay, I'll close on a quick joke. Husband and wife go to a restaurant, and husband is staring at a woman in the corner of the restaurant who's just drinking herself silly, totally drunk. And the wife goes, "You know, I just don't understand you. We finally synchronize our schedules to go out together, and all you're doing the whole evening is staring at that woman drinking herself drunk. What's the matter with you?" So he says, "You know what, darling, I really owe you an apology and an explanation. That woman is my ex-wife. We divorced 10 years ago and she took to drinking and hasn't stopped since." So his wife looks at her with admiration, says, "Wow, who could ever imagine anyone celebrating for so long?" Marriage is not easy, and the jokes are okay. Keep laughing, because you got to laugh to get through life. And happiness in marriage is not about how similar we are and less difference. It's all about how strong will I be in the marriage? How kind and listening? How compassionate? How patient? How understanding will I be? How appreciative? How admiration? How grateful? Whoa, that's a biggie. How grateful will I still be no matter what? Because that's what God really wants from me. And when we change and become more righteous, better in ourselves, the other people will respond in kind, and our children will too. Thank you for your patience. God bless.